Mr. Smith, do you want to read the open public meeting statement?
On Wednesday, January 18, 2023, notice of this meeting was emailed to the press and the Mainland Journal. Notice was also delivered that day to the Egg Harbor Township Clerk and posted on bulletin board in Township Hall.
Roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno?
Here.
Mr. Del Barca?
Here.
Mrs. Gilbert Floyd?
Here.
Ms. Hyman?
Here.
Mr. Ireland?
Here.
Mr. Price?
Here.
Mr. Seppi?
Here.
Mrs. Sullivan?
Here.
Mrs. Salagi?
Okay. Please stand for the flag salute.
I pledge to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I need motion to I need a motion to approve the minutes.
Mr. Price, I'll make that motion.
Second. This is item 4.1 through 4.4. Roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno?
Yes.
Mr. Del Barca?
Yes.
Mrs. Gilbert Floyd?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Ireland?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Seppi?
Yes.
And Mrs. Sullivan?
Yes. Okay, and I'm going to turn this over to Dr. Gruccio, our superintendent.
Hey, good evening, everyone, and welcome to our April board meeting. I cannot believe it's April already. A lot going on. We had a great spring break, and here we are back in action, and we got some action going. Excuse me ahead of time. I'm suffering from pretty severe allergies, so I will not, I promise I will not talk too much. This goes on. All right, I will cover our presentation. As you know, it relates to our student learning goals and under student achievement. Just for the parents who are with us, fourth marking period is here, third trimester is here. Report cards were issued for the third marking period and the second trimester. So if you do not know that, tune into your parent portal and check out how your students are performing. For the month of May, we will be issuing the NJSLA testing. That will occur throughout the whole month of May. We also have AP testing and the science test that will occur at the high school. So, you know, students are going to be a little stressed and uptight and wanting to do their best on those tests. So just keep in mind, you know, that social-emotional piece of this is important, and we're here to support them. STEAM Challenge occurred last month, and STEM projects are going on in our middle school and high schools. Earth Day was celebrated over the weekend, and there was projects and lessons that were our students experienced over the last couple days. National Signing Day for our athletes at the high school. Look at all those universities. We had 13 athletes here, is that right, Mr. Rutledge? And that contributes to another 7 or so. So we have over 20 athletes from the high school that have signed, sealed, and delivered to higher education, and we're very, very proud of them. They represent EHT, and they move on to their new university. Climate and culture. The Noche Latina event was held again in the end of April, and do a great job with welcoming our Latino families in as they come in for dinner and learn about the resources we have here at, in Egg Harbor Township. Bubbles for Autism was celebrated throughout the school district, and we continue to honor our students of the week and students of our month. Just a reminder, Administrative Professional Day is tomorrow. So we appreciate our secretaries and administrative assistants who assist us each day. And I told mine today, I was like, I don't know what I'd do without you because, you know, you're my memory and you take care of things probably before I even know about it. So I thank her very much. Take Your Child to Work Day is this Thursday, and we will be celebrating that in all of our schools. Spring celebrations are going on and have gone on prior to spring break, and after as well. And After School Professionals Appreciation Week is this week. I sent an email out to our faculty and staff to, hey, give someone a high five that spends that time after school, puts in some extra effort to be with our students, to give them relevant learning experiences, you know, whether it's on the softball field or in some of our schools that host our Aspire program or our Talents program. So thank you to those folks who spend extra time with us. Community partnerships, we had career days throughout the district, and that's so important. As you know, vocational education is our goal, is our mission to expose our students to the careers that are out there, whether it's college, career, CTE, vocations. Important that we expose them to some of the opportunities that they will have. The Atlantic Care continues to partner with us in the Green Mustache Contest. There's little Emma. She's the winner of her green shakes that she tried and she was able to experience over at Davenport. Bus drivers are needed. I continue to say that and stress that. We need bus drivers in the school district, and we've reached out. We have a part of our PACE program is we're offering a CDL program to our students 18 and older. And Jeff Ziegler was here to share his Holocaust story, this time at Fernwood, and I believe the NJEA will be doing a spotlight on there. Mrs. Wazin joined him, and it was a great time over at Fernwood. Swift Sleigh Ball participated in a class cleanup all around there near Castle Park. Students were out there helping to clean up the area. Our pre-K Spring Festival will be May 11th at Sleigh Ball Primary. So if you're interested in participating, come on out. It's after school. And a BMX assembly was held at Swift Sleigh Ball by the Dial Action Sports. That was really cool. I know Ms. Moss and Mr. West attended, and there was a good time. And last but not least, our apprenticeship meeting was held right here in this room last Wednesday. It was awesome to see our business partners here who joined us to learn about the programs that we have and to share the opportunities that they have as they partner with us by accepting our students who could go to their businesses and participate and learn. So that has taken off. The participation was double this year than it was last year. So it was neat to meet those folks. Okay, at this time we have a presentation. The Village Grand at English Mill, their holiday gift drive occurred last year. And each and every year, we want to thank the men's club. So I know Jerry Sakin, you are the president of the club, but I see that you have some members as well and representatives from the community. So I'm going to hand the mic over to you. And we thank, on behalf of the Board of Education, we thank you for the donations of those $100 gift cards to our students at Davenport, Miller, and Eagle. And I'll give you the rest. And you sure you don't want to come up, Mr. Groff? You don't want to come up here? Come on. I know you like the spotlight. We don't have anything, any food for you this evening, but I can guarantee you a spot on the camera.
But can I just say one thing? This is the first school board meeting I've been to in 12 years since I retired as superintendent.
Well, what are you doing?
We've been doing this fund drive for about 12 years now. Over the course of the 12 years, our community, which is right around the corner behind the high school, we've raised $84,245 and been able to give students in the schools $92,674 worth of gift cards. And it's been our pleasure to do it. We look forward to doing it again this year. And it always amazes me the generosity of our community. Last year we actually had a couple people donated turkeys at Thanksgiving through the Eagle Academy. Somebody donated a TV, somebody else donated a Christmas tree that went up in one of the schools. And it's the partnership. Doug and I were both in education for a very long time. We've got a number of other educators that live in the community, and we know how important it is to the kids and to the families to have this kind of partnership, but also there are so many families within Egg Harbor Township that need the additional support. We're happy to be able to do that. I do want to recognize Mr. Smith at the Eagle Academy, Mrs. White, and Mrs. Caruso at Davenport School were very helpful to us in finding out which students, which families needed the additional help this year, and we were able to coordinate the distribution. So we look forward to doing it again this year and for years to come, and we're happy to be able to do it.
And we truly appreciate your generosity. Thank you. And with that, I present to you a certificate of appreciation to the Men's Club of the Village Granite English Mill. And please proudly display that, that the Board of Education, the students, the parents, and administration. We appreciate that.
And we have a couple of other members. You guys just stand up back there.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you. Same here. Take care. All right, that concludes our my presentation regarding our school district learning goals. I'd like to give you a visual. Alan captured what was going on the last month here in the district. Thank you again, Alan. Always like to give a visual of what's going on. We're so large, so many things going on throughout our district that we're very, very proud of. So thank you again for capturing those moments. And at this time, I'm going to turn the presentation over to Mrs. Carugno, the high school principal, who is going to present the board with information. I think you're, do you have something up here?
I do.
And looks like she has. Yeah. All right, some information on therapy dogs. And I just want to make it clear that there is a difference between a therapy dog and a service dog. So if you just keep that in mind, because sometimes when we get in the gist of things, things cross and we get blurred. There's a difference between a therapy dog and a service dog. Is that right?
That's correct. Thank you, Dr. Gruccio. As an athlete, I feel like listening to Guns N' Roses before we came up here kind of got me a little bit pumped up. So I'm super excited about this. I thank you for having us here tonight. I'm Ms. Carino. I am the principal at the high school. This is Kim Benton. She is our behaviorist at the high school. And this is Michelle Lambert. She is one of our special education teachers. And we did this as a team, so I felt that we should also present as a team. This this idea actually came from Ms. Lambert and Ms. Freund last year. She was the the supervisor of special education. We've gone to Absecon schools to see how this was done, and that's how this, our PAWS program really started. So we'd like to tell you a little bit more about it. So we called ourselves PAWS, Pets Aiding for the Well-Being of Students. And so our plan is essentially to get two dogs, Marty and Charlie, into the high school so that they can help our students with any social emotional needs that they may have. We're seeing this more and more across the county, across the state, across the entire nation, that there's a lot of evidence to prove that students do a lot better having a social or having a therapy dog around. One of the things that we are not seeing is we're not seeing them in the high school as much. I want to be a groundbreaker in putting them into the high school. You see them a lot in elementary. My kids are both in college. They have a ton in college. But for some reason, we're skipping that high school population. And that's a population that I don't know if we think that they get it, but they don't get it yet. So they would definitely have a population that we're going to focus on. So Marty is a German Shepherd, Labrador Retriever. He is about a year and a half. Charlie is a Greater Swiss Mountain Doodle, so a little bit hyperallergenic. He is about 4 years old. This process we started last June in, number one, making sure that the dogs would be trainable and it would even work with this. I don't like going back and forth, sorry guys. Would be trainable and would even work for this program. So since then, they've become members of the AKC. They've gotten the Canine Good Citizen Award, which is one of the best awards that the dog can get. It means that their demeanor is amazing, that they can work with people, they can work with children, and they don't get rattled. And that's one of the part of the trainings that we have. They're certified through the the Alliance of Therapy Dogs. They've been therapy dogs at Tim Tebow's Night to Shine. If you don't know what that is a prom for special needs students and adults. It is one of the best nights I've ever been to. It was held at the local church over here. So if you ever get an opportunity to go and see it, it was really good. These dogs are currently working with the elderly at Brandywine Nursing Home, Preferred Care, and Summers Manor here over in Summers Point. So they are now actively in working positions. For both of the dogs, they know that there is a difference between when they are working and when they are at home. That when they are working, they get a red vest to put on, and they're both aware, this means I'm going to work. It is a different, it isn't, you're bringing your dog, it is you are a working dog, and that's exactly how they handle it. So here's just pictures of Charlie and Marty getting their Good Canine Citizen Award, which was really great. And then, just a little bit about what we're gonna do. Like I mentioned, it was for social, emotional, and physical well-being of our students and our staff. This is happening in hospitals, and they're not just bringing in dogs for the patients, they're also bringing in dogs for the doctors and nurses. Here I'm speaking with a member of our audience who is currently working at Absecon, and she is a nurse herself. I'm not going to point her out, but she said that she has the program at Absecon is wonderful, and she's looking at it not only from an educational point of view, but also as a nurse as well. So what we're looking at is we're looking at students to decrease their anxiety, to make them more comfortable at school, to have them handle crisis situations. So everything's going to be data-driven, focused on SEL, beneficial to all, and everything's going to be based upon our MTSS, the multi-tiered system of supports. So from here, I'm going to turn it over to the absolute professional on MTSS, Ms. Kim Fenton.
Thank you. I appreciate it. So some of the questions we have are, who does the program benefit? So of course the program is going to benefit the students in a couple of different ways. We're going to target them through three different tiers, which I'll talk about when we really dive into what we're going to focus on from the data perspective. But the students are going to be able to be focused on through academics, behavioral, attendance data, and just through interacting with the therapy dogs. It's also going to be open to the teachers to make sure that they have additional resources. Sometimes I find that my teachers become very frustrated because other than the teen center, other than some counseling, like what other supports do we have, especially coming and still recovering from the pandemic, hitting situations of grief that hit our community as a school and as a larger community in general, like where else do we get support for that? And the therapy dogs really would be able to fill a gap in that area to offer that additional resource. It also benefits our families because they can utilize that resource in general by referring or asking for a referral to the program, but also can access the dogs at school-wide events. So part of this process is having them integrated into the culture itself and making sure the dogs are visible at sporting events, at our unified events, or any kind of large school event that we have. And just the community in general can utilize the therapy dogs because the dogs will also be present at different community nights throughout the year, like Memorial, they'll be at the Memorial Day event. The Pride event, and then first night. So I kind of got brought into the loop because this is great, right? And it's a beautiful idea, but how do we quantify it? How do we measure it against other interventions that we're using to prove that it's working over time? So we have a couple different proposals for that. So the whole thing will be data driven. So students will be selected in a 3-tier system. The first tier is directed towards making sure the dogs are accessible and visible in general to as many students as possible. So that part of the program is called Paws in the Halls. So we will take data on this through quantitative and qualitative surveys just to kind of get a feel of how kids feel in general throughout the school day, and if adding this intervention helps increase their positivity and productivity throughout the day. A tier 2 intervention will target more small groups. So these kids will be chosen based on going through our INRS process or through attendance data, for example, so we can target truancy. And a lot of times we also would like to use them to target social skills, right? So use them in smaller social skills groups. And it's not only about the productivity of the social skills group, it's also about the attendance. Like, I can run a counseling session, but if kids don't show up or would rather be at lunch or would rather be doing something else, and it's not mandated that they have to be there, just kind of an open resource, well, how can we incentivize them to come and spend that time with us in a really quality way? Adding this as an additional resource could help us do that. So another way you could take data on that is about the duration of the sessions that they attend, the frequency of the sessions they attend, and then if when we put the intervention in place, those things increase, and also through momentary time sampling. So the tier 3 intervention that we would use is something called Pause for Praise, where we're actually using the dogs as reinforcers. So kids would be able to spend more time with them based on different individualized objectives that they're meeting throughout the day. Sometimes these can be tied into IEP goals. Sometimes they can be tied into specific interventions like attendance, for example. Like if a child who has frequent attendance issues comes in on time X amount of days, they could possibly be someone who comes and helps out with the walking of the dogs or spending extra one-on-one time with them. So how would we actually introduce it and integrate it throughout the school day is also a phased approach. So a really big part of this too is making sure that the dogs are comfortable, right? Like making sure that they're able to handle this from an environment perspective. Like the school's really big, so we would have to enter them in different phases. Do you want to talk a little bit more about that?
So in the first phase, one of the things that we would do is we would obviously tell the community, tell our students, tell our staff about the dogs. We would have opportunities. We have video ideas that we can put out on social media. We would have opportunities for the community to come in and meet and greet the dogs. We were able to bring the dogs in today. The Board of Education was able to meet and greet with them. They're both pretty docile dogs, so they're pretty chill. But you know, we would also talk about the most important thing. And you know, I think Mr. Price, you know, had asked, "Hi, do you mind if I talk? You know, if I talk to your dog, like can I pet your dog?" And we want to make sure that the students know that there is a process. You can't put your you know, face in a dog's face. So we would go over what the rules and regulations are, and we would also post them throughout the school so that they were, you know, people would be familiar with exactly how to engage with the dogs. Okay, we have, you know, pause before you pet. You know, we have the pause before you post, which we changed that up a little bit. We would also introduce the handlers. Right now we have 10 staff members who are current handlers for the dogs. So that's a great number to essentially start with. And then we could introduce them. So if this does get passed by the Board of Education, we could introduce them at the Professional Development Day that we have in May. And then we can continue to have meet and greets throughout the evening and the different community events. The second phase would bring them into a small group instruction. Again, if this were able to get passed this year, we could start that in June, and we have permission slips for students who were specifically going to work with those with the dogs. If this for phase 3, what we would do is it would be integrated throughout the school day. So the dogs would go to work. The dogs have a full schedule that they would have to follow on a day-to-day basis. So again, I want to reiterate, it's not a bring your dog to work. Your dog is going to work, and they have a schedule just like a teacher's schedule would be. So with that, I know some concerns are always, well, how do we know who has allergies? How do we know who's afraid of the dogs? One of the things that goes out every year is a health form that goes through our health and phys ed classes. That would be part of that health form. Any parent or any family that does not return that form, we would call them and we would make sure that we got that. So there is a thing called a no response. We don't want that. This is a definite response. You either can be with the dog and be around the dog, or you can't. And we would never want to put any child, you know, in a position where they felt uncomfortable around the dogs at all. So the visibility, if you look here, the therapy dog on premises, that would be in any location that the dog is. We would have handlers. The handlers would be clearly marked in bright colored shirts. So if the dogs were in the hall, any student from far away would be able to see that a handler is there. I want to make note that there's never a time when during passing that dogs would ever be in the hall. Dogs would only be in the hall when students are in class, all right? And then again, we would post times when everybody, where everybody would be. The impact, we talked about this a little bit earlier, about it's already in hospitals. I know Kim had mentioned times of grief and crisis. I talked with a student that graduated last year, recently lost a family member. She had said to me that in college, that she has a therapy dog, and she said that's the first place I went when I found out that my family member passed. And I said, can I share that story tonight? She said, absolutely. So, in the board, in your packets that we gave you, the last article in there is about how a high school adopted a dog after a crisis at a high school. It's very similar to that, all right? And then all of our handlers are certified by the Alliance of Therapy Dogs. It is not an easy process. Like I said, we've been working on this since last June. They all have to be well-mannered. Every handler has to pass with the dog. After they pass with the dog, they have to take an oral test. They have to go with the dog to locations. It is a very, very long process. And they don't just pass with the dog, the dog walks next to them. They come out at the dog, they scream at the dog, they almost take like a cane and are hitting it near the dog just to see if there's gonna be any reaction. And if there is, the dog doesn't pass, the handler doesn't pass. So it is a very long process and very well done. So we put some FAQs, some of these, we kind of, mentioned, about how to become a handler, what's this gonna cost the district. This is the most beautiful thing for the board, it's nothing. We do have a grant, thank you, from Atlantic Care, Healthy Schools. So that's great. Insurance is done by homeowners insurance and insurance by the Alliance of Therapy Dogs. And then we also mentioned, how will the dogs be introduced? And biggest thing here is to differentiate between the three. As I mentioned, to do a therapy dog, it's a very detailed process. Very different than a service dog that is trained for a specific person with a specific disability. Again, different than an emotional support animal. Okay, that helps their owner with their therapeutic. So with a therapy dog, that is designed for this entire room as opposed to the other two types of dogs. And this, here's some pictures that we've taken over the past year. This is Marty. He loves to lay down when he starts to get tired. He just kind of, he lays. So, obviously this is a very young child, with Marty. And then here are just pictures of our handlers at some of our senior homes, just taking some time to pet the dogs. And there are rules. So if you look here, you see Marty by the bed. Dogs can't get up on the bed. Like the head can go on the bed. And so there are specific rules that need to be followed. And that's it. So we hope that the Board of Education will accept our therapy dogs and vote yes. And I'm sorry that took so long, but something very important to us. So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, ladies, for that thorough presentation. And the board has a policy to review for its first reading this evening, so I appreciate that. At this time, we're going to move on to our. You have questions?
Madam President?
Yes.
I just have a quick question, Jackie, if you would. I met Marty and Charlie. I'm very impressed, very nice dogs, and I think it's a great program, and I'm looking forward to it. My question was, you're going to start with the two dogs. Are there any plans to add on, and are you going to maybe look to implement this in some of our other schools as well? What are the future plans?
We would absolutely love, we want to see how this works first. You know, we want to look at the data, you know, see how the how it's incorporated by our student staff and the community. Being the size that we are, again, we started this at Epsecon. They have two dogs. They are probably an eighth of the size of the high school. Would it be great to incorporate more dogs? I think absolutely. You know, we have the handlers. Again, that takes time, so it's not something that could happen overnight. It would have to definitely be a process. I know some other people that are principals at other schools that are asking, "Hey, I'm hearing this is happening." Right now at Davenport, we do have not us, but there's a therapy the dog that does go in once a week. I think it would be great to have that more as a permanent thing because they become a fixture of the school. So, yes, it would be something that we would 100% help every school incorporate.
Okay, thank you very much,
Virginia.
Thank you for the presentation. You clarified a lot of my questions that I had earlier, so thank you for that. I just had one quick question. I don't know if you said it already. I'm sorry if you did. The handlers, so they are already certified with the dogs, or they are going to go through that process?
So right now we have 10 handlers that are already certified. Some are finishing up some of their home cares. Ms. Lambert has a fabulous spreadsheet of when everybody's there, when everybody's going to be done, and then, as I mentioned, the dogs are going to be AKC therapy certified at their 10th. That'll be at our next visit in May. So by the time June happens, 10 will be completely certified, ready to rock and roll. Right now, we have 6 that are completely certified.
We have 10 certified now.
Oh, I'm sorry, 10 are certified.
6 complete in June.
Okay, so.
16 or 10? Okay.
We'll have a full 16.
And during the day, will they be switching from handler to handler, or will they both be working in the school with one handler every day?
So they will be switching. The handlers, it'll be part of their duty. So that will be, they'll be assigned to the library, or they'll be assigned to child study team. If you look in the packet, everybody has a location that they need to be at. And we do have a location in child study team for the dogs to have personal time with the students, and also it's a downtime room for them as well.
Okay, so they'll have their time to rest as well. They won't be
correct
technically
because it is,
it's stressful.
It is stressful for them, right? And I know sometimes, when we get in the car after, because when we go to visits, the dog comes out and they're like, oh,
yeah,
that was long.
No more, no more people.
Right.
And then another quick question for the data.
Sure.
How will we measure or, prevent students, especially at the high school, using it as an excuse to get out of class?
Thank you.
Yeah. No problem. I appreciate the questions. I think that's a really good question, and I think as a behavior analyst, that's something that I get a lot for like any intervention I run. So a lot of times it's like, well, why are they going to your office? Or, what does this look like? So there's a really big difference between a reward and a reinforcer. And what that looks like is a reinforcer increases the probability that they'll engage in a behavior again. And all of those things are really measurable, and measurable from an operational perspective. So if we can clearly define what those behaviors are and then look for those increases, we can compare them over time. We can also look for correlations between, are they leaving at the same day every time? Are they, we have really good communication systems between the passes, between the teachers being able to communicate, knowing what those schedules are. And also we can negate some of that by having those scheduled time versus having just random interactions of, oh, I need to see the therapy dog versus it's my scheduled time to see the therapy dog. Mm-hmm. I also wanted to kind of add to that question of, you know, can we do this in other schools and is it able to grow? With the ability to measure it and quantify it in the way that we're presenting, it is scalable and it's able to be replicated. And that's why we kind of took this fine-tooth comb approach of attacking it on different tiers and having a way to do that, because you can make it larger or smaller depending on the need, and you can put it in different places at different times and compare those across. Like, we would love in a perfect world to be able to take this data and to build on it, or like present it at the next NJEA conference, or even from a behavior analytic perspective, like take it back to the board and say like, hey, here's this program we're able to build and we're able to prove over time that it was successful.
I just kind of, sorry, keep on beating a dead horse here. With the insurance part of it, so the handlers, from what I'm gathering, they've kind of already signed on to this, the duty to take care of the dog during their scheduled time. What if something should happen? I know that the dogs are trained and they're not reactive to, you know, something, but some kids, you know, they don't listen and they'll, you know, do something to taunt the dog. So if in a case something does happen, the insurance would cover that, or the homeowners and the, I guess, the alliance?
Yes, they would be double insured, you know, through both of those policies.
And that would protect the handler as well?
Yes. Okay. Because you're insuring the dog.
Through the alliance?
Yes.
Okay. Because they've gone through that certification?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Anybody else?
I just want to say that when I first saw the pause, I said, wait a minute. I said, okay. All the thoughts came across my mind. I think some of this Bajorno said too. You know, you think about a dog, you're thinking about if the dog bites someone, if a child taunts the dog. You just, all the thoughts come across your mind. You're like, okay. Just some things sticking in my mind as well. But there are two things that I do believe that can calm the savage beast, no matter who they are. And that's animals, especially dogs, and children, like babies. Like, you see the toughest, roughest, meanest person kind of melt when they see a dog or melt when they see a baby. So I'm hoping that from a therapeutic standpoint, some of the things Ms. Fenton talked about, I'm hoping that it will, I hope it'll stop some of the kids in their tracks and just kind of make them stop and think when they see an animal. I mean, it sounds, it's different, very different to have a dog in the school. A therapy dog in the school, but just having an animal in the school. But I think it's going to be, I'm hoping that it does what you set out for it to do, is to assist the students and help them. I hope that it works, and I believe that I think it's a great idea. So.
Thank you. We're super excited, and we can't find any data out there that says otherwise.
Right.
You know, we've looked, you know, trying to play devil's advocate.
I'm going to take it back to my district and say, hey, listen, see what they say, but I think I'm looking forward to it. I think it's going to be a good idea for the.
I would love to be the trailblazing high school in this area to make this happen.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, you're welcome.
Okay, thanks again. We're going to move on now to our public budget presentation. I just want to remind everybody, those are new visiting us this evening, this process began when spending started
October.
Last July, right? So, you know, we spent the money with that budget that was approved, but in October, the process began. So, a series of meetings with administrators, researching and then presenting to us the needs of their buildings, taking that all into account, having presentations here at the board meetings from supervisors and regarding their areas, listening to directors, their needs, and taking all that and compiling it all together. We're very fortunate. We have an experienced business administrator with an experienced assistant business administrator who was previously a business administrator. So I have ultimate faith in these two folks, in their numerical experience and the calculations ability that they have to present to us, and they have presented to us a balanced budget that has a 1% increase, but you're going to explain all that to the community, why that is, and I think it's pretty tight, and I'm impressed with the work that you've done and the efforts that you put into this. So here we are, the day that we all wait for, the presentation of the budget to the Board of Education of Egg Harbor Township and the public of Egg Harbor Township. There you go. That's all.
Okay. All right, thank you. So as Dr. Gucci said, Mr. Germano is here tonight as well. We're going to present the budget. No videos, music, or animals, but nonetheless still important information. So we'll get through this pretty quick because nothing has changed since our March presentation. So at March, if you recall, you approved the preliminary budget. It was submitted to the County Office of Education for review. They did have us tweak some narrative pieces of the budget, but none of the appropriations, the total budget didn't change, anything like that. So this will be pretty straightforward. I know we did, between March and April 7th, we did get a few questions from some board members. We were able to answer those, send that information out. We do have all the updates for your binders that you could put in your binders tonight. We use different color paper, so it kind of stands out so you know what the final version is compared to other versions. So we'll go through the presentation, and then if you have any questions at the end, we can answer them at that time. So again, our goals that we're focusing on when we build the budget, board goal number 3 is providing resources to positively impact student achievement. So that's a major goal. And then district learning goals 1 and 2, providing literacy for all and supporting climate culture and EHT pride. So those are the goals we have in mind as we're working with administrators and supervisors and building the budget. So tonight we'll look at our budget dates, some program highlights, our revenues, what board action is needed tonight, and what our next steps are after tonight. So from October until the present, we're working with our admin team, creating budgets, reviewing budgets, going back and forth, asking a lot of questions. For myself and Mrs. Germano, this was kind of an odd year because we came in not really having a lot of knowledge about the district, so we did ask a lot of questions. You know, at first, I think some of the supervisors were saying, hey, why are you asking me that? But, you know, we got through the process, and it was a great experience. Everyone did work together. And here we are today in April. March 2nd, our state aid figures were released. March 20th, we sent our preliminary budget that was board approved to the state for approval. And tonight, April 25th, we're holding our public hearing. As Dr. Gruccio said at our board meetings, we've done multiple presentations starting back in November. If you can remember that far back, our first meeting in November was our first set of 3 or 4 content area presentations. We've had our discussion as a whole, and again, everything is in the Google folder, so if you have any questions or want to recall a document we went over, everything that we shared in the binders and in presentations is in that Google folder. So now I'm going to turn over to Mrs. Germano for some program highlights.
All right. Tonight we're going to discuss facilities, technology, and academics specifically that were evaluated based on needs, balance, and maintaining the sustainability of the district. First and foremost, we're going to continue to service and repair the HVAC equipment. This is a large undertaking in a district this large. As a result, we're adding an HVAC mechanic to help maintain properly the equipment that's currently in the building. We have several planned capital improvements, including an alder elevator rebuild. We are going to be upgrading the building automation systems in throughout the district. This will be done with local funds as well as ESIP funds. We are beginning phase 1 of the Miller roof replacement. We have budgeted ROD grant money to match if we are successful in getting that grant, along with professional fees, which is primarily architectural and engineering fees. Additional capital improvements include the Alder Middle School bleacher replacement, Davenport gym floor replacement, phase 3 of the high school door replacement. This is a multi-phase process and will continue after phase 3. We are going to rebuild the high school loading dock. In addition, for security, we're adding a security coordinator, and a significant amount of professional development will be added throughout the district with the new director and the coordinator in place. These items are being funded by increased state aid. The facilities projects will be added to the long-range facility plan, and we will be looking into all possible grant opportunities, including the ROD grants and the preschool facilities expansion grant that is currently available. For technology, we're looking at installing a new district-wide phone system, unfortunately, everything goes up and software and firewall costs are part of that. We can plan on continuing maintaining the one-on-one initiative for our students. We are utilizing E-rate funding, which will be approximately $98,000 in savings to the district. We are also looking to add an e-sports arena at the high school. From an academic standpoint, we are going to continue implementation of tiered support in kindergarten through 12th grade and add a reading specialist at Alder and Fernwood. It'll be one teacher for both schools. For career technology education, we are going to upgrade the industrial arts room and add a 12-month supervisor for a growing program. For math, we are going to continue whiteboard deployment, which has already begun and is popular in the math departments from my understanding. That we will also be adding a high school algebra co-teacher. For special education, we'll be adding a language learning disabilities teacher in the middle school, an emotional regulation impairment teacher in the middle school, a learning disability teaching consultant in the district. We'll also be reclassifying part-time para positions that we've been struggling to fill for full-time positions. We'll continue using contracted positions through Therapy Source and Interactive Kids. For social, emotional, and mental health, we have already started with Empathy Rocks. This is a third to fifth grade program. And a Kindness Counts, which is for kindergarten through second grade. Both are working on empathy and kindness among the children. We also have Effective School Solutions, which helps with behavioral and mental health among our students. Athletics will be getting some upgrades as well. We're getting, at the high school, a new scoreboard at the softball, for softball, basketball, and the football stadium. The weight room will be seeing some renovations. And as always, we have the collective bargaining increases in salaries and benefits. Policy 4250 and 4411 are staff that are not included in those collective bargainings that are still part of the upcoming budget. But I'll turn it back over to Dan.
All right, so now we'll get into our revenues for next year. So we'll look at our tax levy, both general fund and debt service fund, our state aid, and an overall revenue summary. Excuse me. So this is a quick snapshot, last 5 years of our general fund tax levy. And as you can see, there's been kind of ups and downs throughout that. But over the last 5 years, we've gone up just over $2,060,000, which is about 2.67% increase in 5 years. And that's kind of important because a lot of other districts, mostly smaller and some larger, have seen significant increases in their tax levies, minimum 2%. Some districts have gone above that. So the district has really, over the last few years, really kept the taxpayer in mind when building the budget and trying to balance the tax levy versus increases in state aid. So a good thing for the township, and then trickles down to being a good thing for the district. Ratables have increased over $36 million for this year. Meeting with the township and working with them on upcoming development, that number should grow. There's a lot of things coming online in the township, a lot of things to be excited about. Of course, the negative is more students in the same classes that we currently have, so we're planning for the future as we go through, but it's an exciting time for the township. With the average assessed value at $210,668, which is a slight increase from the previous year, and our current school tax rate is 1.9413. So if we look at that rate, if that rate were to stay flat with the increase in ratables, we would generate $707,920 in new revenue for 23-24, which is about a 0.9% increase in the tax levy, so just under 1%. So we look at that same information and we look at our board approved 1% increase. It brings our new tax revenue in next year's budget to $791,880, which is a rate change about 0.2 of a penny. And annually, that's about a $4 increase on the average taxpayer at that $210,000 assessed value. So the difference between those two scenarios is $83,960. So that was us going to 1%, generated that additional almost $84,000 in revenue in next year's budget. on the debt service fund. Again, this is linked strictly to our long-term debt. So you'll see the kind of tax levy is pretty steady. And you'll see that 5.5, 5.4 million for the next couple of years as we go through paying off our long-term debt. And really 26, 27 will be the last year that'll kind of be at that level. So that's when we'll look to add new debt on. So as this current debt falls off, it'll be replaced with newer debt. And that's really big referendum type projects. That's building additions, new schools, renovations to spaces that currently aren't instructional spaces. So those will be major projects. And I know you're familiar with the process. There's about a year-long process. So around January of 2025, we'll really begin that. And lead up to December of 25 for a public vote on those projects and that referendum. That new debt would then come online in around 2027. So we want to try to keep that amount steady so that the taxpayers don't see a huge decrease and then all of a sudden another increase again. So the same information is used regarding ratables and average assessed value, but our current debt service tax rate is 0.1348. So when we look at what our required levy is, there is a slight decrease in next year. So it's about $3 annually for the average taxpayer. When we look at general fund and debt service combined, overall it's about a $1.47 annual increase, or about 12 cents a month for the 23-24 budget. And this is just a quick bar graph to kind of show where we stand versus the county and the state as a whole. So the top section, the blue section, is our municipal property taxes. The middle maroon section is school tax, and the bottom orangey color section is county taxes. So we're below average in compared to the county and the state. For school taxes, we're a little bit above the county, but below the state. So we're kind of in the middle as it stands, comparing ourselves to the state and to the county. And this information is available from the Department of Community Affairs website. They have a lot of good information out there. We just kind of put this chart in to kind of just show where we stand compared to our neighbors and across the state. So state aid, very big portion of our budget along with our tax levy. So you can see the 17-18, which is the initial year prior to the legislation being enacted, Chapter 67 or S2, where we still were at $41.5 million. In next year's proposed budget, we're just under $81.3 million, so a change of $39.7 million. So over the last this will be going into our year six, we've increased our state aid by almost $40 million. And again, that was taking reallocating aid from overfunded districts and giving it to underfunded districts. So we were an underfunded district, and we've been receiving increased equalization aid because of that legislation. So that calculation includes something called the adequacy budget. I know we've kind of talked about it. I just wanted to include one slide to give you a little bit more detail. It's a hard concept sometimes to understand, but it looks at weighted enrollment and at-risk enrollment. So when we look at our total enrollment, we start with our elementary level students, and you kind of think of them as zero, and then middle school gets a factor added, and high school another factor to account for different expenses related to those grade levels. And then we also look at-risk enrollment, so any students who qualify for free and reduced lunch. The state looks at those with those factors and determines our weighted enrollment. So our total actual enrollment might be 7,400 students, but our weighted enrollment is about 9,500 students. That's where our aid is based on. Then we take that weighted enrollment, we multiply it by a per pupil cost, and then a geographic cost adjustment. So wherever you fall in the state, north, central, south, those per pupil amounts are prorated based on where you live. So we actually get less than 100% of the per pupil account, per pupil amount, excuse me, compared to other districts who may be a little more north of us. And then the last piece is special education. So regardless of what your special education population is, the state assumes 15.9% of your students are special needs. So that goes into the factor as well with another per pupil cost, and that becomes your adequacy budget. So your adequacy budget is how much you should be spending based on for instruction for those students that are in that weighted enrollment. And you can see this, it might be a little hard to see, but our adequacy budget is about $138 million, and our local fair share, which is what the local taxpayers should be contributing to the budget, and it's based on equalized valuation and district income, and kind of the district income lags 2 years behind and equalized value lags 1 year behind. We take our adequacy budget, subtract the local fair share, and get our maximum equalization aid. So $69.6 million is our maximum equalization aid. And that's where we're at in next year's budget. So when you look at our state aid notice for 23-24, our equalization is $69.6 million, which is an increase of almost $35 million. So it's gone over 100. It's gone up over 100% going into year six of the legislation. Year 24-25 will be the last year of legislation. So a year from now, when we're looking at the 24-25 budget, we most likely will see another increase in state aid. It may not be equalization aid. And we saw this year, we capped out our equalization aid and we received additional transportation and special education aid because those other aid categories are now filling up because we're maxed out. So we're gonna see that trend again next year. It's not going to be as much as it was this year because the goal was to phase out. So when you get to the last year, it's kind of a smaller increase and not a huge increase. Same with districts on the opposite end, districts who are losing funding, they'll see a smaller increase next year than they saw this year, or decrease, excuse me. And this is a revenue summary just for our general fund revenue. I know it's kind of small, so it is attached in board docs, but I wanted to try and get everything in and you kind of see where the breakdown is. So the top part is our state aid, $81.6 million. Then we have our Medicaid reimbursement program, or the SEMI program, $228,000. Then we have some local sources, $871,000. Our proposed tax levy of just under $80 million. And then we do have fund balance and some excess surplus funding next year's budget of $3.2 million. So a total general fund budget of just under $166 million. The next part is our special revenue, Fund 20. If you recall back in March, we discussed the different funds, 10, 20, and 40. So this will be Fund 20. So this is money that's restricted for specific purposes. So the top part, a $7.8 million, is for preschool and non-public funding. And then we get into our local sources, which is revenue from student activity funds, which stays in that fund. It doesn't go to the general fund and transfers to preschool. So any inclusionary costs in the preschool program, we have to transfer funds from the general fund over to special revenue to cover those costs because they're not covered by the preschool grant. And then the last section are federal sources. Those are all entitlement grants, title grants, IDEA, Perkins, and ESSER. We are budgeting Aspire, so we are applying for that grant again. We're hopeful that we'll receive it. We won't know for another month or so, but we are applying for that for funding for next year. And then I wanted to go a little more detail on Fund 20 for ARP ESSER. So we have about $4 million remaining that we're going to spend over the next 12 months. And these are just some things that are being funded by that money. Summer of 23 EHT Ready Program, middle school extended instruction, out-of-district tuition, ventilation supplies, elementary playground supplies, special education related services, and as Mr. Mata mentioned earlier, the Effective School Solutions is being funded through our ESSER funds. And the important thing to note, out of all these items, the only thing that will maintain after the funds expire in 12 months would be the out-of-district tuition. So any cost charged there this year will go back to the general fund, but all of the other programs and supplies and purchases that we budget in there will kind of fall off as that money expires. And then the last fund is our debt service, Fund 40, strictly just made up of local tax levy and state aid. So overall, we have our general fund, like I said, just under $166 million, and our special revenue and debt service, which are restricted funds. So our total budget is $192,300,633. So board action. So for tonight on the agenda is for the board to approve our 23-24 budget with those totals shown and the two tax levies broken out. And again, same amounts and breakdown as the March approval. Okay, so our next steps after tonight, we provide all of our tax and budget information to local and county governments for certification. We load all of our information into our accounting software so we can start preparing to open up our accounting system for July 1st. We will start working with our professionals on all of our capital projects. We have a lot kind of ready to go, and we kind of tell everyone after the public hearing we'll give you the green light to move forward, so we'll start that process. And then once we get everything loaded and ready for July 1st, we're going to start working on the 24-25 budget. So there's a lot of different things that Mrs. Germont and I will go through in the early fall that we didn't have a chance to do this year, but there's a lot of exercises we'll go through that will help not only us get another layer of understanding on the budgets, but help the administrators prepare for the year after 24-25. So we know the way we've been living with increases every year, that's not going to happen. So we're going to start a year early, looking really in depth at our budgets, looking at all of our personnel. For example, we're currently renewing our health benefits, and I hate to say nickel and diming Horizon, but Mrs. Germont has been really working hard with Brown and Brown, who's our advisor, and even little things that's, 50 cents per employee per month, we're looking at, and we're trying to figure out where we can make cuts, whether, no matter how big or small they are. So that's an ongoing annual process. All right, so that's our presentation. If anyone has any questions, we can answer them now.
Questions?
Patrick?
Just a quick question for if we get the Aspire grant, where are we going to shift that money to, like the $130,000?
Well, that's if we get the grant, that's what we're expecting to get at a minimum. So if we don't get it, then most likely the program won't continue, and then Miller School parents would fall under Talons. If we do get it and we get more, with special revenue, we budget an estimate, and then if the grant is approved, whatever that grant amount is, that kind of gets plugged into the budget, whether it's more or less than what we budgeted.
Thank you.
Regina.
Thank you for the presentation. I just had two questions. You had mentioned on the ESSER funds that the other items that fell under that, once this expires, special education related services. So this area of like the resources that we've provided these several years to special education, are we being proactive? You just said that we're going to be looking and kind of finding the pennies to put together to make sure that we can fund those for the next year. Is that what I was understanding?
No, so those funds expire August 31st of 2024. So all of our ESSER money will be spent by then, and then things like the ABA therapist, which is a big chunk of that ESSER allocation for student services, once that money expires, those services will go away. So when those services were brought in, they weren't brought in as a long-term solution, they were kind of a short-term resource.
Mm-hmm.
So we're moving towards that, and I know that was in planning with Mr. Dorso. That's part of our budget planning. Now obviously he's retiring, so the new director will come in and we'll work with that person on that same plan.
Okay. I will make a note to try to make sure that we were proactive to accommodate special education with their resources, so that we're not giving it to them and taking that away, because that could be a downfall. And then my second question was on the capital projects. Is there any, I know that we had spoken about this before with the economy, the way it is with the backlog and the delay in supplies. Are we experiencing that as well with the HVAC still?
Yeah, we are. It's gotten slightly better, but we are experiencing that. So a lot of our, right now, it's April 25th, we're probably not going to get any HVAC done work in the summer of 24, because things are that backlog. Depending on what you're doing, if it's smaller units, they're kind of more readily available. But just for example, the Swift chiller that was just replaced a couple weeks ago, we were on the verge of renting another chiller because we didn't have confirmation that it would be here, and then it was in transit and it got lost, and then it appeared, and then it was going to the coating factory, then it wasn't. So and then we're doing chillers at Davenport and Slayball, and we don't even have set dates. They should be here in July, and the work will be done in the summer, but we haven't confirmed that yet.
And do we have a backup plan if they're not, if that's going to be a disruption to the next school year or July?
No, because our backup plan would be wait until October. So if we can't do it over the summer, You know, we only have to run our air conditioning until October 15th, so we would do the work at that point. Okay. The difference with those two, we're in a little better shape. They at least have a working chiller. Swift had nothing.
Nothing,
so,
right.
Yeah.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay. Yep.
Madam President.
Oh, Mr. President.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead, Mike. Thank you. Thank you, Lou. Just a quick question. Great presentation. You have it well laid out. It's easy to understand. And I know we had questions, and I know I had a question that I submitted to you, and I did receive a reply. But I just want to go over it again. The per student spending on this budget, can you give me a breakdown again? What was the actual per student? What's the state average, and what are we spending?
I don't have it in front of me. I forgot my binder at the office. But we're kind of average. I think we're a little below the state average in the per pupil spending amount.
Okay, but we don't know where we are on actual state at this moment then. What are we spending per student?
I'd have to look at the memo that was sent out to the board. Like I said, I don't have it in front of me.
Okay, because I don't either. Okay.
A lot of that comes from the budget software. So if you look at your budget document, there's a per pupil calculation page that will show you what our ratios and percentages are and amounts. And then we take that and we compare that. It's called the Taxpayer's Guide to Education Spending. So that
No, I understand the process. I was just wondering where we were, what the actual amount was.
I think we're right at average or slightly below as far as spending per pupil. And obviously with the increase in state aid, if you track the last few years, you can see our numbers going a little higher each year.
Okay, so I'll go back to my email. I think it was in there somewhere, but I just wanted to, you know, confirm it tonight here on the record. Okay, thank you.
Mr.
Okay.
Della Barca.
Thank you. Thank you, Dan and Jen, for the great presentation. I thought it was one of the best presentations I've seen in many years that I've been on this board now. If you were to meet any community member came up to you at this time and asked you, how much more taxes am I going to have to pay for schools next year, what would your answer be?
A very minimal $1.47. Depending on your assessment.
I know the community's going to question, how come we're raising taxes? Mm-hmm. And I want to be able to explain that the minimal, because I know the township is raising also, and I know that folks in the community are going to wonder, well, how come we got all the state funding, federal funding, why we're raising taxes? And the answer is?
So we want to be consistent. Going to the 1% is a slight increase over what the increase would just be for the ratables, but we're looking at our long-term plan. So we have a few different things kind of working for us. The township is developing, which is great. We do have an open communication with the township on different things. We're exploring shared services. And at the same sense, the board has invested a lot into capital projects and capital improvements. And we realize that that's not going to be sustainable. So we have a lot of projects budgeted that, you know, 2 years from now, those appropriations are going to go away. So that will offset not getting those increases in state aid. So we're trying to just keep the tax levy as steady as possible. That's our plan. That's our goal. And that's the directive of the board. So that's what we're doing. And again, it's part of a long-term plan.
And I truly appreciate your answer. Thank you.
I think you can see that not only are we have a plan for this year, but it's the future as well. And I think that is smart budgeting, because that's our job, is to look into the future and see, you know, what's coming at us. We know that enrollment is increasing and it will continue to increase. Having conversations with the folks from the township administration, we are getting new developments with close to 1,000 new kids coming over the next 5 to 6 years. So including next year, they're coming in. You know, COVID, we all experience the after effects of COVID. There are folks from other states who found the Jersey Shore in the beautiful town of Bay Harbor Township. So we are experiencing an increase in enrollment. So I thank you both for your insight and your foresight when planning this budget and presenting it to the board. It was Atlantic County approved, who represent the Department of Education. And we're proud to say that, you know, we've done a good job with our numbers.
Okay. One more from Ms. Hyman.
Again, that was a really good presentation, and I was able to follow along, so it was really good that you presented it this way. I just have a question. I see tonight we're going to vote on an increase of 1%, which is going to be about $83,960. My question is, last year we gave back $1.8 million to the taxpayers. I'm just a little confused about why we did that last year, as opposed to maybe leveling, you know, giving it out a little bit over the year so we won't have to increase. So can you explain that to me?
No. I wasn't here, so I'm not sure what the, you know, method was to that decision. I'm not sure. I agree. If that was the goal of the board to give money back, I probably would have split it and said, well, let's do half, and then we'll do a little bit next year. But again, it happened. So we had that factored into our calculations for how do we get from here to 5 years in the future without seeing a major increase and without having major budget reductions.
Thank you.
Okay. I'd like to open it up to the public now only on the budget. If anybody has any comment or would like to speak to it, we'll take you at this time. Come up and provide your name and your address.
Good evening.
Turn
this on?
No.
Okay.
Is it on now? Okay. Amber Umflett, 6512 Mill Road. I actually have something else to say later, but just great presentation. Blast from the past. Been here before. So this was great. I love seeing everything, how you laid it out. My concern is when districts, we have our students leave. Have we been able to get a handle on that? Because I know that there was a couple questions about where our students are. So just FYI, we used to be very, very under. So when our students would leave our district, we would have to pay an astronomical amount of money to ACIT and other places. So I just want to remind the board that where we've been and where we've come is like huge leaps and bounds. And the money that you've received has been a huge long fight for a lot of us. So I just want to commend you on just, you know, being able to use your resources and expand the schools and do what you've been able to do. So, but my question was just, you know, just looking at some of the questions that were asked, what have we had, has the state or has anyone had a solution about, you know, other districts raising like the choice schools, the ACIT, have they been able to wrangle that amount? So where we are, as we're increasing a little bit, they seem to be increasing as well. So we're still paying an astronomical amount of money, you know, to those schools. Part two of that would be, I know I'm coming tonight, hopefully in a little bit, when you open it back up for community partnerships. I know that, you know, some of the things on your budget have been geared towards the high school and trying to kind of reestablish some of those programs at your high school to maybe keep those students in the high school, which, congratulations, that's amazing. I know another, you know, long battle, uphill battle that, you know, I'm so glad to see you guys be able to bring that to the high school. So I just was curious if, I know that was something that we've always been fighting for, and I wasn't sure if, you know, included in the budget, like, have we allotted that amount of money for our students that have to go out of choice, you know, to choice schools or to ACIT or, you know, to other, those other types of schools. And thank you. And great job. Good to see everybody. Thank you.
Yep. So I guess two parts to that question. One, we do have that tuition information that we have to budget for those other districts. I will say that Atlantic County, their tuition rate is actually going down slightly for next year because they got an increase in state aid. But we do have a good communication with them, and we obviously want our students to stay here, and that's what we're working on. So sometimes it might look like we're investing a little more in the high school. You know, part of it could be to make sure we maintain those kids with our expansion of preschool. We're hoping that that helps, so we get kids here when they're 3 and 4, we get them in the kindergarten, and then they never leave until they graduate high school. So that's kind of the plan that we're going through.
Any other questions on the budget? I'm going to close that.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Smith and Mr. Germana. Great job.
take a little breather now.
Yeah.
Well, that's right, we have to vote. Anyway. All right, so that's really part of the superintendent's report tonight. But before I close, I just want to remind the Board of Education about our continued conversations that we've had regarding transportation change involving the Alder Avenue Fernwood Middle Schools. As some of you up here have experienced with us over the years, we've had to make changes for equity regarding programs, facilities, or transportation purposes. So through the years, it's varied. And this research process began a few months ago. And it involved a few factors, and one is feedback from the Department of Education, who noticed that our student-teacher ratios were off. Fernwood class sizes were much higher, and as I mentioned before, with the increased enrollment coming up, we see them to grow even more. Two, we don't have enough space in Alder to accommodate our incoming special education program. And three, we don't have enough bus drivers to continue busing students from the Fernwood neighborhoods to Alder Avenue Middle School. To be clear, and for the record, that this operation decision was not made lightly, yet once we made the decision, we wanted to be transparent and inform those involved as soon as possible. This concept was shared with the Board of Education through committees over the last month or so, and we shared the information with parents of the 71 students who will be currently affected by this change. We've sent a letter. We continue to answer questions that parents had over the phone. We also had a parent meeting for both schools on April 19th, and during those meetings, one here at Alder and one at Fernwood, the administration explained the process and provided parents with information and provided tours of the building and a map as well. We had one parent attend Fernwood Avenue Middle School, and we had approximately eight parents attend with some students here at Alder. As they said at that meeting, we are Egg Harbor Township. We are proud to be EHT. I am confident that all students will have equal opportunities in each of our middle schools. We have mirror schools. They provide resources, the same resources for our students. And, you know, we have to think about it. Our students are all together in Miller School. They separate for 3 years, but they come together at Egg Harbor Township High School as one. So it pains me to hear if anyone thinks that the two middle schools are different. Physically, they are different. You know, their contents may have different teachers, but we have the same programs. I publicly understand, and I want to express that folks are upset. However, we have listened to concerns. And for instance, we were asked if we can schedule the students coming over from Fernwood to Alder in the same pod so they could be together. Are we going to offer transition? Are we going to offer tours? Yes, yes. Do we have counselors for social emotional reasons? Yes, absolutely. We will certainly do our best, continue to do our best as we always do. And I thank those parents who came out and expressed their concerns, but I wanted to share that with the board as to where we are. Okay, thank you, Mr. Sullivan, and that concludes the superintendent's report for this evening.
We're going to continue now with our student representatives. They'll give their reports.
Hello, everyone. So to start off, I'll talk about how during Women's History Month, the Atlantic County Women's Hall of Fame visited the high school to share their stories and words of wisdom with young women like myself. I was there, and I thought it was a great opportunity to meet and learn from other strong and inspirational women near me and see the impact they've had on my community. Secondly, on Monday, April 17th, students at Fernwood attended a presentation from the son of a Holocaust survivor. Jeff Zeiger told the story of how his family survived the Holocaust thanks to a neighbor who helped hide his family for 18 months, and concluded his presentation with a reminder to students about how one person can make a big difference in the lives of so many. Next, this past week, the Egg Harbor Township High School Orchestra went on their long-awaited and anticipated trip to Boston, and in which they explored the Faneuil Hall area of Boston. They watched the Boston Symphony Orchestra. They toured Boston University, explored the Newbury Saint neighborhood, and they took a cruise on the Boston Harbor before competing against several ensembles in the World Strides competition. So best of luck to them on their upcoming competition performance. And then lastly, at the high school, freshmen of the social studies department are finishing up their Marching Madness competition, which is like a really fun competition that freshmen do, in which they debate crucial inventions like the camera or like the refrigerator or vaccines. And they do this as part of their unit on the Industrial Revolution. So that's what they're finishing up.
And I'm gonna continue. Hello, everybody. So over spring break, more than 20 students from the high school took part in a hiking expedition that took them to the landscapes of like Bryce Canyon, Zion National Park, Sunset Crater, and other fantastic locations across the Nevada and Utah area. And this adventure provided students the opportunity to immerse themselves in nature's beauty, and they pushed themselves to limits by hiking trails well over 25 miles, which is super long. Last week, the high school academic challenge team traveled to the Atlantic City High School, where they partook in the annual Viking Quiz Bowl competition in an attempt to prevail as competition winners over 15 other regional teams from Atlantic and Cumberland County. And in the fields of STEM and other general knowledge, the students showcased their strong teamwork and intelligence and managed to earn third place in their fourth round competition, so congratulations to them. Throughout the last 2 weeks, several students from both Fernwood and Alder Avenue Middle School worked on creating unique science projects related to microbiology, bacteria, physics, and other topics for the Delaware Valley National Science Fair. And with their hard work, several students managed to place first and second as recognition. And despite all of this, most of these students were only in the sixth grade and had a competition in the seventh and eighth grade throughout the tri-state area. But with their intellect and dedication, they managed to create the perfect project and overcome their challenges in the competition. And Fernwood Avenue celebrated Poetry Month with their Hispano Blantes classes, where they engaged in various creative writing activities. This involved crafting acrostic poems throughout the inspiration of their heritage. And this worked in embracing the diversity throughout our middle school while allowing students to venture beyond their comfort zone and share both their personal and cultural identities. That finishes my report.
Thank you. We're moving into our second public comment. The board values and welcomes comments and opinions from residents. This meeting will now be open to public comment, 3 minutes per person. This is on agenda items only. If your questions pertain to litigation, student, or personnel items, please see the superintendent after the meeting, as the board does not discuss these matters in public. Depending on the nature and complexity of your questions, the board secretary may ask for your contact information so that someone can get back to you with a response. As a reminder, this is a public meeting and all comments should be appropriate for a public setting and made in a respectful manner. Please come up to the podium, give your full name and your address, and again, this is on agenda items only.
Watch how I creatively do this.
Okay, Amber Umflett, 6512 Mill Road. So I am going to creatively use the budget to let you know that we, as Community Partnership, we are supporting a lot of your budget items this year, one of which is the pre-apprenticeship in career education PACE, the CTE Career and Technical Education Innovation Lab. Last year, we raised $25,000 to help you upgrade your high school sign, which we bought in 2000 and installed in 2010. So with that said, I have wonderful tickets here that I wanted to, I don't know where they are. Anyways, I have tickets for our Dyson's Eye next year, and we sent out an email to all of you for your attendance. We would love to have you guys attend as we are here supporting your budget and supporting things for the students in your district. We would love to have you a part of that and be able to see some of the honorees. We are honoring Atlantic Care this year, and also Cameron Bell. So we would love for you guys to be a part of that. I have tickets. All of you know how to get a hold of me. So if you can do that, and there's so many people out in the audience, if you guys want to attend too, you just look at our website, Community Partnership, and you guys can be a part of it. It's a really great evening, Dice and Dine. So that's how I creatively made this about the budget. So thank you guys so much again. we have raised over $500,000 for Eggover Township School District. So we've put in a lot of great things, playgrounds in each of the elementary schools. So we would love for you guys to be a part of this. And you know, this year, I feel like with your budget items and us collaborating with you guys and supporting you guys, you know, we're really great. We're really excited about the great things that you guys are going to do at the high school in this area. So thank you guys so much again. And I'll have tickets till Friday on sale. Okay, bye.
That was very creative. Any other comments about agenda items? You can come up to the podium. Agenda items only, though.
There's a button. Oh, the one
that
says push.
There you go.
Wow, so smart. So I noticed earlier you kind of went over emotional and how the students are affected, right? That's part of the agenda, kind of. Okay, good. So I noticed one thing that affected a lot of kids in our school and made them really...
Oh. Before you start, your name and your address.
Oh, my name is Mirabel Colombo. I live on 106 Offshore Road, EHT, and I'm an eighth grader at Fernwood Middle School.
Thank you.
I noticed a lot of girls in our grade became really uncomfortable with the dress code. A lot of people would be walking around, and it's just really unfair and kind of sexist, fairly. I noticed that throughout the day, people would be upset that if they got dress coded, and it would affect the rest of their day. It's also aimed towards people of different body types. For, say, people that are curvier or bigger have targeted more, while people that are skinnier and smaller don't get dress coded. And I got dress coded first thing in the morning. I've been in school for 1 minute, less than that, and I got dress coded, and that really set me up for a bad day personally, because you don't want to be dress coded first thing in the morning, and it's a skirt I wear all the time. And I thought, like, oh, maybe this was bad, but every time I went up to an adult in the school to talk to them or something about anything, they'd be like, oh, I really like your outfit. And I was like, oh, thanks, I was dress coded for it, and no one really understood why. And I think that also it's required to have a certain degree. When stores aren't selling that anymore, things are shorter, and it's just not what is sold. And I noticed that a lot of people don't particularly like this, and it's just affecting them a lot.
We appreciate your comments, and we'd like you to go through the chain of command and talk to your principal at your school. Okay, I'm going to close this public comment time, and we're going to go on with our agenda.
I'm sorry. That's okay. Hi, good evening, everybody. My name is Darla D'Alessandro. I live at 30 Gallant Fox Lane in Egg Harbor
Township. Actually, I spoke to a few board members up here. I did have a concern. I came up here prepared with a totally different speech. I had the pleasure of speaking to Ms. Moss yesterday over the phone, and I just would like to thank you for listening to my comments and concerns. My concern is not with the change of schools from Fernwood to Alter. I totally get it. I know, understand the process, overcrowding, transportation. I get it. That's not my issue from changing from Alder. I'm sorry, from Fernwood to Alder. My development was changed. The only people so far that have been reached out to are the people or the parents that have sixth and seventh graders in the Fernwood, which is totally understandable. I understand that. We have to give them first priority. They're switching from, you know, school to school. I understand that. However, I feel as though that our development has been Fernwood, known to be Fernwood for 15 plus years. So along with myself and other homeowners in the development, we have not been notified that our homeschool has been changed. So I have a neighbor who has an 11th grader, an 8th grader, and a 4th grader. Why would she think anything different? I'm coming up here because I was just dissatisfied that there was no communication on that part. I have a fifth grader going into what she thought was Fernwood. I found out from a neighbor who told me that my homeschool has been changed. I didn't hear from anybody else. My daughter was upset. She will be fine. She's going to Alder now because, you know, we've seen the map. We've done all this. So after I spoke to Ms. Moss and explained the situation that, you know, homeowners in my development want to be told that our home school has been changed. And that means it could be, you know, kindergartner. You know, people might have moved into our neighborhood thinking that they wanted to go to the Fernwood school. But, you know, I get fire drills, lockdown emails, and I can't get an email that my home school, an important change, you know, like that has been done. I don't know the redistricting laws. I don't know if that should be coming from the township, the county. I'm not sure, you know, how that it doesn't even have to be known to make, you know, someone like myself, a taxpayer, known that my homeschool has changed. I don't know if that should be public knowledge or not. But after talking to Ms. Moss, you know, she understood where I was coming from. The people in my development just want to be notified that, you know, our homeschool has changed. It doesn't matter if you have, you know, a kindergartner, a first or second grade, a third grade, you know, like I said, 15 plus years, our home school has always been Fernwood. If you're going to change it, you know, we would just want it to be notified. And after speaking to Ms. Moss, which I would like to thank, she understood where I was coming from, and she had suggested that she would probably be able to pull all the parents that do in our development or all the affected developments. I know it's just not my development. There was a couple other streets or developments that have been changed. And she, you know, came to the conclusion that maybe she could actually pull all the children that attend Fernwood, who's now going to go to Alder in the affected developments, that they would be notified. So, you know, I just want to thank you for that. And also, I understand that the fifth graders are going to go into an orientation, and us parents will also be notified that our children are also now going to Alder and no longer Fernwood. So thank you for taking the time to speak with me yesterday. I really do appreciate it. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on now to finance and operations. I've asked.
Okay, thank you, Madam President. I'm filling in for you as chair. Well, you're chair, and I'm going to read the report.
Yep.
So, anyway, the Finance and Operations Committee met on April 18th, 2023, at 6 o'clock p.m. Length of the meeting was 60 minutes. Board members attending: Mr. Price, Mrs. Sullivan, Ms. Alagi. Administrators attending: Mr. Germana, Mr. Woodrow, and Mr. Smith. Subjects discussed: Transportation Department. Mr. Smith noted that the state inspections are wrapped up and the department did not have any vehicles placed out of service. He noted that Mr. Jones and the mechanics have been doing a great job keeping the fleet running smoothly. Food Services Department. Mr. Smith noted that the department is continuing to work on the equipment replacement plan, and the New Jersey Department of Agriculture review will begin on April 24th. Facilities Department. Ms. Caroline Jackson, district's Honeywell representative, gave an overview of the energy savings plan that the district has been working on for the last 12 months. The ESP has received all necessary approvals and will be board approved on April 25th. Ms. Jackson noted that projects will begin this summer with LED replacement lighting throughout the entire district. Business office. Mr. Smith gave an update on the vacant bookkeeper position. Mr. Smith also discussed a potential lease of preschool classroom space for the 23-24 school year. After group discussion, it was decided to put the potential lease on hold and to explore other in-district options. Mr. Smith reviewed items on the agenda for approval, including monthly reports, tuition contracts, professional service contracts, New Jersey Department of Education facility project submissions, and amended grant applications and acceptance of funds. Mr. Smith noted that the 2023-2024 budget had received county approval, which we heard tonight, and was advertised in the newspaper, and it will be presented for final approval on the April 25th. He noted that the full budget will be provided to each board member for their respective binders. And I just wanted to note that I did research that the per pupil spending is $20,190. So that I answered my question I had for you earlier on the presentation. That kind of coincides with what we discussed here. So anyway, conclusions reached. The committee recommends moving forward with the action items discussed. Ongoing issues still under consideration. Security items in May, natural gas buses in July. Recommendations, there were no discussions or anything of that nature. Next time, place of the meeting, May 9th, 2023, 6 o'clock p.m., board office. And possible topics to be discussed, security information update. And again, if you have any questions or need more information, Ms. Sullivan.
Thank you.
That concludes our report. And if you have anything, maybe Mr. Smith can address it at the moment. Thank you.
Anything further from you, Mr. Smith? You're good?
Yes, we did have a couple questions come in, so we do have a couple updates. First one, biggest one being, well, I guess all of them are from the bills list. So we had a purchase order for Tactical Public Safety for repairing a bus radio. So that was a repair for one radio. So the amount included on-site labor and repairs made at the vendor's facility. So the technician couldn't repair it. He had to send it in and send it back, which is why the price was so high. We had a question on a couple purchase orders submitted to Dell. One was for 6 desktop computers for the teen center. And the other was for a server for the IT department for additional storage space. There was a question on a couple purchase orders made out to Follett. So in the update today, there were 2 links for those 2 purchase orders, so you can see which books were actually ordered on those. There was a question on the plans for the greenhouse and completion. So right now our district architect, Mr. Hopkins, is wrapping up the technical specifications, and we're hoping to get the bid out in the next 2 months or so. And then based on those results, we'll decide what direction we can move in. Then the last question had to do with 2 purchase orders for Ocean Construction regarding repairs. The first was for curbing and sidewalk and drainage or inlet repairs at the entrance to the bus garage. That job is complete. The second was for a small repair at the Alder School. So that had to do with the concrete that was poured for the outdoor classroom area. There was a small existing slab that had to be repaired. So that project was that repair of the existing slab, and that's also complete. So those are the finance questions that came in.
Thank you. I'm going to start with a motion to approve finance item 9.2.
Motion. Ireland.
Second.
Second.
Any questions? Roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno?
Yes.
Mr. Della Barca?
Yes.
Mrs. Gilbert Floyd?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Ireland?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Seppi?
Yes.
And Mrs. Sullivan?
Yes. We're going to move on now to finance item 9.3. I need a motion.
Motion.
Mr. Price, I'll make that motion.
Second.
Second. Mrs. Floyd.
Roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno?
Yes.
Mr. Della Barca?
Yes.
Mrs. Gilbert Floyd?
Yes. Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Ireland?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Seppi?
Yes.
And Mrs. Sullivan?
Yes. Now we're going to approve finance items 9.4 through 9.25. I need a motion.
Motion.
Second. Ireland.
Any questions? Roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno?
Yes.
Mr. Della Barca?
Yes.
Mrs. Gilbert Floyd?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Ireland?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Seppi?
Yes.
And Mrs. Sullivan?
Yes. Now we're going to move to curriculum. We're going to hear curriculum's committee report. Ms. Bongiorno?
Yes, thank you. The curriculum committee met on April 18th at 7 p.m. for the length of time of 1 hour. Attending was myself, Ms. Hyman, Ms. Gilbert Floyd, Mr. Seppi, and Mr. Seppi joined us from 7 p.m. to 7:15 p.m. and then he left our meeting, and Ms. Barbara Stalagi had joined us for the remainder of the meeting. Administrators attending was Ms. Moss, and we discussed, we reviewed professional development and field trips. The ARP ESSER 3 Safe Return Plan is being reaffirmed, is required by federal government as a recipient of the grant funds. Upcoming contracts for System 44 and Behavior Therapy Associates were discussed, as well as the acceptance of the New Jersey After School Program and School Climate Change Grants, which is amazing. Administration also discussed their intent to apply for school-based mental health grant and Bipartisan Safer Communities Act Stronger Connections grant programs. Mr. Seppi spoke with the committee about opportunities to partner with Philadelphia Sport Team to allow our students to attend a game or games and have hands-on experiences. Updates were given around the plans for eighth grade recognition ceremony, the bus lines for the middle school, and comments from the last curriculum meeting were addressed. Boosters will be running the camps for the summer programs and schedules modifications were shared as well. The date and time of our next meeting will be May 9th at 7 p.m. at the district office, and topics for discussion are summer work. Thank you.
Ms. Moss, do you have anything to add?
I was just going to address a question that came in. It's on the new business for the calendar, but it did address professional development, which falls under curriculum. So the question was around the amount of professional development days for the upcoming school year. In the EHTEA contract, our teachers have 184 days, which allows for 4 full days of professional development. And then any half days that are added in are at the district's discretion to meet the professional development needs.
Madam President, I just have a question in regards.
But can I make a motion first and then you
Certainly.
Can We need a motion for item 10.2 and 10.3.
Motion.
Second, Ireland.
Any questions?
Okay, yes, just one question on curriculum. The New Jersey School Board Association, the Firearms Task Force, I just wanted to get an update. I don't know if this is gonna be something that's gonna be handled in curriculum or if this is gonna be through the New Jersey School Boards Association. What's the time that we should discuss it? How do you want to handle it? Under curriculum or under your school boards? Because I think Lou was going to address something on this as well.
I'm not sure. That is not on our agenda tonight, so I think we're going to go through with this. And
we discussed
this
in closed.
We
did discuss it closed.
Right, we discussed it in closed session. And I think
So just to remind everybody that we should not be discussing what we discuss in closed in public, and that security typically is an executive topic just because of the reason to keep what we do for security confidential. And I think what Ms. Sullivan is trying to say, let's finish the motion, and then if there's the question on how we're handling it, we could discuss that after the motion.
Okay, I just wanted to get an update on the New Jersey School Boards Association Task Force for the firearm safety, that's all.
We have a motion on the floor,
Mr. Price, I second that motion.
We did that, so roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno?
Yes.
Mr. Della Barca?
Yes.
Mrs. Gilbert Floyd?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Ireland?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Seppi?
Yes.
And Mrs. Sullivan?
Yes. We're going to move on to personnel now. Okay, Dr. Charlton, do you have anything else to add to it?
I do not, Madam Vice President.
Okay. What do we move on? Got it. I need a motion for 11.2 to 11.7.
Motion, Del Barca.
Second, Ireland.
Mr. Smith, you have a great job.
We're going to have roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno?
Yes.
Mr. Della Barca?
Yes.
Mrs. Gilbert Floyd?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Ireland?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Seppi?
Yes.
And Mrs. Sullivan?
Yes.
Okay, I get to speak again this evening. All right, so for those of you who have waited patiently for this time, and I appreciate it, especially the children that have been patiently waiting and paying attention, I'd like to welcome to our school district three new employees this evening, and that is Eel Velez, who is our accounts payable bookkeeper and will work in district office. Welcome. Mr. Robert Davis, who's hired as a special education teacher at the high school. Will serve as the football coach at the high school. And Tatiana Cunningham, principal of Alder Avenue Middle School. Congratulations to everyone and welcome. And at this time, you know, feel free to go out and celebrate what's left of the evening. And okay. All right. And we won't be offended if you walk out. We'll try. All right.
Okay, I'd like to call on Mr. Ireland for the policy committee report.
Awesome, I'll keep it under 3 minutes. Okay, so I'm giving out the policy committee as the chair. We met on Tuesday, April 18th, and our board meeting lasted about 56 minutes. Members that attended, myself, Mr. Seppi, Mr. Del Barca, Ms. Hyman, and Mrs. Salagi. Administrators that attended were Mr. West, and others was Mrs. Helgalko. Subjects that were discussed during this meeting was the bylaw 0168 recording board meetings. Number two was the therapy dog policy. Policy 5200 attendance, and then the regulation 5200 attendance. Policy 4411 placement on guide step bus drivers. Policy 4250 hours and days of work. Bylaw 0164.1 conduct of board members during public meetings. So the conclusions, bylaw 0164.1 conduct of board members during public meetings has been revised by the committee. Bylaw 0168 recording board meetings has been revised by the committee. The therapy dog policy will be a brand new policy established by the committee. Policy 5200 attendance is a mandated change from Strauss-Esme, supported by the committee and revised by the committee. Policy 4250 hours and days of work has been revised by the committee. And policy 4411 placement on guide step bus drivers has been advised by the committee. We have some ongoing issues that are still under consideration is regulation 5200 attendance, and that will be reviewed and revised by the committee on May 9th. Our next meeting is Tuesday, May 9th, and that's at 5:00. So that is all I have for my report. Mr. West, did I mess anything up on that?
You did not, Mr. Ireland. Perfect.
Awesome.
Okay, I'd like to have a motion for 12.2 to 12.7. Motion and second.
Mr. Price, I'll make that motion.
Second, Ireland.
Any questions?
Yeah, I have a question on policy. I think it's for the solicitor. Are all the policies back in full force and effect now? After the pandemic, some of them were put on hold and so on and so forth. That's all over and every policy is now back officially in place. Is that right?
So yes, we said when the health emergency was over, it is over, so they're back in full force and effect.
Okay, thank you for the clarification.
Roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno.
Yes.
Mr. Del Barca?
Yes.
Mrs. Gilbert Floyd?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Ireland?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Seppi?
Yes.
And Mrs. Sullivan?
Yes. Okay, let's see. Do we have anything from the NJSBA?
New Jersey School Board Association. There will be a leadership conference for all of you on May 17th at Resorts in Atlantic City. It's from 9:00, from 10:00 to 3:00 with registration at 9:00. Mr. Smith will be the registrar if you are interested in attending. It would be nice for some of us if we could go over there that day. It's an all-day meeting at Resorts for Leadership Program. Hopefully on Tuesday night, May 2nd, we have our Atlantic County School Boards Association final dinner of the year. It is a hybrid dinner, in person and virtual. It is at the Summers Point Great Bay Country Club in Summers Point from 6:00 to 8:30, and the topic is cybersecurity. We'll also be recognizing individuals who have achieved different achievements during the course of the year, and districts who may have achieved some accomplishments during the year, and also at that time there'll be elections for new county officers. So hopefully some of you can attend that on next Tuesday night. It should be a good evening. And that's all I have to report at this time.
I kind of jumped out of order here. I'm going to go back to new business. We have item 13.1 and 13.2. It's for our school calendar and for our safe return plan.
Motion, Hyman.
I'll second the motion.
Questions?
About the professional development. So back to the, we had four this year for the coming 20th school year. And this year we had, I think it was a total of 8 or 9. Is that contractual? Last year we had more this school year because of the contracts?
So there were more half days built in last year. So we still have some half days built in, just not as many as we did last year.
And we just did more professional development because we had the half days.
Correct. Okay. So now we still have the 4 full days because mm-hmm. that's what's contractual. Mm-hmm. And then the half days is what the district puts in based on the needs for that year for professional development. Does that make sense?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. I was just wondering why we went from so many to not as much.
But this year was our first year back, mm-hmm. you know, so there was a lot of new things going on and we wanted to make sure we had that time. And so now we're able to, with our plan for next year, fit it into this schedule.
Understood. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno?
Yes.
Mr. Della Barca?
Yes.
Mrs. Gilbert Foyd?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Ireland?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Seppi?
Yes.
And Mrs. Sullivan?
Yes. Now for old business, we'd like to 14.1 affirm our HIB. Motion?
Motion, Hyman.
Second, Mrs. Gilbert Foyd.
Roll call.
Mrs. Bongiorno?
Yes.
Mr. Della Barca?
Yes.
Mrs. Gilbert Foyd?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Ireland?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Seppi?
Yes.
And Mrs. Sullivan?
Yes. Okay, we're going to open up our final public comment. This can be on anything the public would like to speak about. We'd like your name and your address.
Hi, James Fish, 838 English Creek Avenue. I know we kind of shut it down a little bit earlier, but I would like to talk about, I had the opportunity to talk to Dr. Gruccio recently about educating parents and guardians on safe storage and handling of firearms. I'm referencing specifically the state's report that I'm sure you all have read. On page 8, down the bottom, it says local boards of education should consider adopting resolutions to endorse school districts singly to inform families about safe firearm storage. I have to apologize to Dr. Gruccio. I did not mean to Pearl Harbor you tonight with this. We spoke earlier and what we had decided was we were going to wait for the state's recommendations. I had the opportunity to speak to the State Board of Education and they told me that there will be no further recommendations. This is their recommendation. This 58-page report that I'm reading from kind of urges local board of eds to take initiatives to inform parents and guardians. So I don't know if you've all got the proposal that I put forth, but that's what I would like to do. And in addition, perhaps make the suggestion for the board to make an ad hoc committee that would unpack this 58-page, very extensive report by the state. Thanks.
Sir, would you please say your name and your address? You did not say that at the beginning.
Yeah, I did.
Oh, you did? Oh, I'm sorry.
I did.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bless you.
Thank you again. Just to give you an update, since our conversation, I believe I did mention our conversation on the phone that I would be meeting with the chief of police. That meeting occurs this Thursday. I also mentioned that Mr. Alan Bloodgood, our director of safety and security here, is versed and trained on the topic. So we're already off to a great start. And our intention Thursday is to form that collaboration, as the report suggests that we do, to talk about how we are going to roll this out for Acover Township and Acover Township School District. And I've shared that with the board. Mr. Delavarca sits and Mr. Ireland sits on the county committee, and we're all on the same page. Mrs. Hyman had mentioned it at one of our last meetings, so as soon as we get the pieces together, we're ready to roll. If you all know me by now, I want to be the first, and I want to do it the best, so we're off and running with it. So you could be assured that we are taking it seriously, and we are embarking into this project.
Great, thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions for the public? Board? Can I have a motion? Oh, I'm sorry.
I didn't want to get a chance to do a motion tonight. Thank you. No, I really just wanted to say that just some of the, I know not to speak on public comment, but just some of the issues that were brought up, I thought that in reference to the neighborhoods who may have younger children who the zone of which school they will attend will be affected. I think that's a fair request, and I just think I'm glad she did reach out and have a conversation with the district, and I think that that's a fair assessment and request, just so that they'll know. And I just wanted to also commend the young lady for coming up and expressing her concerns about the dress code, and of course giving her direction to speak with her building principal and take it from there. And I can relate to when she said people that may look a little different or have a little more insulation or curves. I mean, it's a thing. And it's something I think that, you know, I'm very proud of her for coming up and addressing that issue. So I just wanted to say that to that young lady before it come out. That was.
And I want to assure the board I've already put in motion to follow up with that tomorrow, not only with the student, but with the parent.
Oh, sure, I believe that. But I'm just saying, I just commend her for even coming up.
Madam President, I just have one comment as a board member. I just wanted to remind everybody again, Dice and Dine, May 4th, Thursday, May 4th, 5:30 p.m. at the Linwood Country Club. Come one and come all. So I just wanted to get that out there again. Another plug for the community partnership. Thank you.
You're welcome. I'd like to thank all of you for putting up with me. I'm a little confused tonight, my first meeting. So thanks for bearing with me. And I ask for a motion to close.
Motion, Ireland, second.
All in favor? Thank you very much.
Patrick's already in this car.